The U.S. has officially confirmed its first case of reinfection 2 months after first testing positive for coronavirus. A 25-year-old man in Nevada and a 42-year-old man in Virginia fell ill again. And we first told you about the Nevada case back in August. Scientists have since confirmed the reinfection. While there have been several confirmed cases of reinfection worldwide, most of those were mild. These patients in the U.S. are sadly exhibiting more severe symptoms, raising concerns about future vaccines against an evolving illness. Let's bring in pediatrician Dr. Dyan Hes. She's the founder of Gramercy Pediatrics. Doctor, how worried should we be about these reinfections when it does appear that this might be a different strain of the coronavirus that has reinfected these individuals?
I mean, I think that that's what we've been saying all along, that you can't let your guard down with this virus, that even if you've had the infection, I know many doctors who had the infection in New York City the first time around during the first wave, and we all, I didn't have it, but my colleagues, everybody wears the same PPE that they did before. There is this sense, like, I hate testing people for antibodies. A lot of parents want it done. And I feel like it gives them this false sense of security that we're covered. At least we're covered for this season. And I said, no, there's no proof of that. And this is right there showing you. Yes, I do believe that most people who had it the first time around probably won't get it at least this season. But everybody has a different immune system. And right now, we don't know what makes people genetically susceptible to this virus. We know that certain blood types may be A positive. Maybe you have some genetic markers that make, because we see families, whole families getting very ill. We don't know if you're that person. So everybody should be wearing a mask and social distancing six feet apart.
So now we've learned that Johnson & Johnson has paused their vaccine trials after what they said, a, quote, unexpected illness in a participant. People will recall that a little bit earlier, AstraZeneca also paused their vaccine after one participant developed some sort of neurological disorder or illness. I'm sort of curious about these pausing rules. How do they work when it comes to a trial? I presume that there has to be some indication that the vaccine may have triggered the problem and not, you know, something else that the participant may have come in with, you know, regardless of the vaccine.
Yeah, exactly. But it's hard to know. And there's such a scrutiny right now on this vaccine that they're not going to let anything slide. You know, if somebody has, you know, transient muscle weakness or a respiratory infection, they have to work each case up very seriously, because as we know, they are fast tracking this vaccine, and we don't want to take any chances that something is going to harm a patient who's going to get a vaccine. And the likelihood, the truth is that people get sick all the time. So if you're in a drug study that lasts 6 months to 2 years, there's a good likelihood that some of your participants are going to get sick. We just have to make sure that there's no causality, that that vaccine is not the reason that you got sick. And they're doing the right thing. They're pausing it. They're going to investigate it, and they'll move on if they can. And if they can't, they will backtrack and have to, you know, start again.
I note that the president of the United States is attacking our top infectious disease expert, Dr. Anthony Fauci, on Twitter yesterday while holding these potentially super spreader events that he is continuing to do. The White House physician released a letter yesterday saying that President Trump has tested, quote, negative for consecutive days. That would mean that little more than a week after being diagnosed, the president does not have the coronavirus. The question, I guess, doctor, and we don't know the answer, is what kind of test is the president being given? The president's doctors have not shared this information with the American people. So is this normal for individuals, or what kind of red flags do you see potentially?
I mean, I do believe that he probably is negative, because he got remdesivir, which is an antiviral vaccine, antiviral drug. So if that worked, he could not be shedding. There is a possibility and a good chance, and we hope, that he's not shedding the vaccine. I just feel that nobody knows, shedding the virus, sorry. So, and I think in that letter, they said they used the Abbott Binax test, but I might be incorrect, but I think that's what they used, a rapid antigen mm-hmm. test, and they said he was negative. So I do think that it's possible that he's negative. I just don't know why he can't wear a mask. I just feel like we just talked about, better be safe than sorry. Why would you expose somebody to risk? You just had the virus. You saw what you went through. Let's protect other people. Let's wear the mask out of respect for our fellow Americans who don't want to catch a virus, and show them that it is not a big deal to wear a mask. It doesn't symbolize weakness.
Yeah, you talked about in the letter, they did call it the Abbott Binix Now antigen card. And, you know, there are all sorts of medical terms thrown in there, viral loads and CPR data, cycling. And so I know there's kind of different ways to test. Could you give us an idea, how does this test work? And, you know, at the rally, the president said that he wanted to jump into the crowd and give everyone a kiss, the guys and the beautiful ladies, I think he said. And so is this the kind of test that would satisfy you, that it is a clear indication that he would not be able to spread the virus to someone else? How does this test work? What's it testing for?
So it tests for the antigen. So it tests to see if you have active virus shedding in your nasal secretions. So that I'm okay with that test. And this is a test that we're rolling out in massively in New York City, in all of the United States, in the schools. This is the one that we're probably going to end up using in airports to clear people to travel. It's a $5, 15-minute test. It's quite rapid. And the sensitivity and specificity are quite good. So you have to take that into context of how the patient is. So the president looks well. He doesn't have a fever. He doesn't have shortness of breath. He doesn't have a hacking cough. That being said, when you use an antigen test, like I have it in my office, if it is negative, but I suspect that that child has COVID, there's no way I'm going to clear them to go back to school. And I think a lot of doctors are facing this liability because the parents want a test and then they want a note from the doctor or for work saying, I don't have COVID. We all know many people who tested negative multiple times for COVID, even with the PCR test, which is the gold standard, you know, when you test for the RNA. I know one physician in Brooklyn who was actually in the hospital in the ICU who had 5 negative PCRs, and they only were able to culture the coronavirus from his stool after months. So you have to take it into context.
That's really fascinating.
So, doctor, do you think that that's why sometimes the information that we're getting from the president's doctor seems sometimes it seems like he's being sort of evasive, but is it actually sometimes that he's being incredibly precise because we can't say you don't have it, you are cured. All we can say is, based on the testing capabilities, you were unlikely to spread it to someone else.
Exactly. What we can say in our letter is what we write in our letter is our patient currently tested negative for coronavirus. You know, the patient is not showing any signs of any illness. And what we also write is the patient has to be 24-hour free to go back to whatever school or work that they have to do. But there is just this whole gray area. It is too new. We don't know. I do also think that the president's personal physician is not a coronavirus expert. I think he's a good doctor, but I think that he is treading in waters that he hasn't experienced yet, and the scrutiny that he's going to get over every word that he writes, you know, it's nerve-wracking. And I think the best he can say is the test is negative now. Why it took so long for them to say that is a different question.
And that just goes back to what you were saying, doctor, which is why it's probably important, it should be something that the president makes a priority to wear a mask because of all these things that we're talking about, all these uncertainties that we don't know, and a simple prophylactic like wearing a mask, which can prevent the spread if he happens to be, like we, you know, all I've been hearing is that we're, you know, yes, we potentially think that this is okay, but I'll tell you what, I mean, I wouldn't want him within, you know, 20 feet of me because I have no idea what's going on. And the doctors that, you know, have been with him and that have been appearing before the press and sending those memos have not been very clear whether, even we're discussing, Emery, about whether it's precise or evasive. I mean, who knows?
Listen, for every other American,
and then, you know,
you have to quarantine.
Add to that, we started this whole conversation telling people that now we have 2 confirmed cases of reinfection. So add to that, you know, not only the risk that the president may or may not pose to other people, but he's still exposing himself to risk as well.
Good point.
Exactly.
Sorry, doctor, I cut you off and you're the doctor here. What were you going to say?
No, I was going to say exactly the same thing, that we don't know that he can't get it again. And I was just saying, the average American, if you're exposed to coronavirus, you're quarantined for 14 days. And it's like, because of this election, all rules have gone out the window for anybody in politics. It's just a double standard. It's very hard as a doctor to convince your patients that they have to stay home for 10 to 14 days, depending on the scenario, but they see our leaders not respecting these rules. So it's like public health 101.
Yeah, you saw it on display yesterday with the president's chief of staff, Mark Meadows. I mean, just out of common courtesy, a reporter asked him, he's been around the president of the United States who was infected with COVID-19. I don't know if he was wearing a mask and protective gear when he interacted with the president of the United States, but who knows? There's no proof of that. And so he appears before the cameras and before a microphone, and reporters ask him to please put on his mask, and he just walks away, thereby just showing you sort of the disrespect that he has. Forget that, you know, there's always been, you know, that tension between politicians and reporters. This is just as a human being asking somebody to be respectful, and he chooses not to be.
Exactly. And I actually feel that this is what is causing the biggest spread amongst, like, college age students, like this complete disregard for authority. And they're like, well, if they can flip off wearing a mask, then I can flip off wearing a mask. Whereas, like, I find my younger patients, and if their parents are wearing a mask, they're afraid to take off their mask. The kids are really good about it. But then it's like this, you know, this college age who think that they're invincible, and then they see their leader is not wearing a mask. Well, they're like, why should I not go to a bar in Miami and not, you know, have to wear a mask if they're not wearing a mask? Yeah. So it's like this, it's a complete mixed message.
Completely. Dr. Dyan Hes, we have used up a lot of your time. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Take care.